Welcome back to Ucypher and Airsport, Nai Superstars. This last game needs a calm mind and a clear mind to play. And the break did just that for our players. Now they're focused to defend the Ancient in DOTA 2.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Ucypher and Sport Nai Superstars. My name is Vivek, with me is CloudX, and you're watching the Marksmen take on the Akramaks. The Akramaks did manage to barely scrape through in the game of Counter-Strike. Some excellent stuff coming out from them. 16-14 was the score, if I'm not mistaken. Let's see if they can close the day with a victory in Dota as well.
Unfortunately, the last time these two faced off, Akramaks didn't have the upper hand. Marksmen did come out on top, and it was quite a convincing victory as well. However, a little birdie has told us that Akramaks have undergone quite a few changes, and I for one cannot wait to see what those changes are. For the draft, you've got the Batrider coming out from the side of Marksmen. That's going to be their opening pick, but Akramaks go with the Crusader specialty, the Tidehunter, as their first pick. On the back of a Venno, Viper and a Nightstalker ban, I like this. I like the Tidehunter first.
I don't think the Akramaks should hesitate one bit. Just pick up the Oracle. He's a great support. There have been a bunch of buffs to him in terms of talents. It's possible that the Marksman might decide to lane the Batrider versus the Tidehunter, and in this game of just switching up your lanes, you might suffer heavily.
Well, yeah, I like the Akramaks Tidehunter versus the Batrider primarily because the Kraken Shell does dispel the sticky napalm stacks if you continue to take damage over time.
Okay.
So if you cross the damage threshold for Kraken Shell, you dispel the sticky napalm stacks, you stop taking bonus damage from the Firefly, and you can turn the tides of battle back in your favor. Ancient Apparition coming out from Marksmen as their secondary pick. I like this as well. It's great versus the tanky Tidehunter. We talked about this in the previous game as well, where Tidehunter, well, he didn't really prove to be the best possible tool. Crusaders did give a shot with the Tidehunter as the defensive tool, but it didn't quite work out. However, his tankiness cannot be ignored. The Ancient Apparition is fantastic at dealing with high HP strength heroes. And Akramaks, if they were ever thinking of a heal-based lineup, possibly with an Undying, possibly with a Dazzle, that's no longer an option. Ancient Apparition puts a stop to all of that right from the get-go.
The Dire get a ban.
Akramaks pick up the Ogre. He's in roaming forth, should be able to secure the mid lane if nothing else. Got a lot of armor, should be able to trade hits without taking too much damage upon himself. There is an Earthshaker ban. I'd like to believe this is somewhat targeted against Blue Frog. He's been stellar on the Earthshaker. He's going to be still playing the 4 position as per what our birdie has told us. And one thing worth noting about Blue Frog is that although he had a shaky start in the tournament, primarily playing the Spirit Breaker, if you do recollect, he's been pretty decent on the Earthshaker. And the Marksmen do not want to give Akramaks anything that could possibly be a strength of theirs.
Hold the phone though, we talked about changes on the side of Akramaks. Looks like Grape is sitting this one out on their side.
Yeah, Grape
on the other side, Marksmen have decided to bench Red for this game. So Devil Jinpachi is making his debut appearance here on the main stage for the side of Marksmen.
This is the first game that Devil Jinpachi is playing here at the Ucypher League. I mean, he's barely sat out the entirety of round robin one. Been a good cheerleader for his side. He's always been smiling, happy fella. But finally, he gets some action on the main stage.
And honestly, I think it's not a bad move at all. Primarily because, so obviously, I'm not trying to compare both of the players versus each other, but what happens with Devil Jinpachi getting that bird's eye view is he kind of gets a better understanding of his team's weaknesses and strengths. It's sort of the coach role. You get that third party, unbiased view of your own teammates, and you can call a spade a spade. Now, because he's got that insight going into this game, he should be the one to wear the captain's hat, or at least the pseudo-captain's hat, and call the shots within the game itself. Because he knows what's up within each team. He knows which egos need to be managed, which egos need to be relaxed a little bit. But they're going to go with the Sand King as their third pick. Pashu, sparing no expense to pick up the Slark immediately after as well. Now, Slark is something we haven't seen in a long time. I don't think we've seen a single Slark appearance at Ucypher, but it's one of the best ways to deal with both the Tidehunter as well as the Mirana. The Essence Shift Steel, it's not something that can be debuffed by the Tidehunter. There's also the fact that the Anchor Smash can be shrugged off with the Dark Pact. Dark Pact in itself is magic damage, which really does work wonders versus that damage reduction from the Kraken Shell as well as the damage reduction from the Anchor Smash. And you've also got to remember, Pounce is fantastic versus the Mirana. You can't leap away from a Pounce. If you've been caught in that leash, no matter how many leap charges you have, you're going nowhere while the Slark is, until the Slark is done with you. To add a nice little cherry on top, at level 25 or somewhere along the way, Slark gets a talent that increases the punt's lease duration as well. So this is really one of the better ways and one of the more ignored ways of actually dealing with the Mirana in this meta.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Akramaks.
I like the Slark pickup. I think with the AM Sun King, they're going to be able to kill the Tyrant early on. This might not be as straightforward a game as the Akramaks might be hoping for in that offlane.
I presume
the Ogre's the 4 position?
Yeah, I would assume it's a 4 position Ogre and then a 5 position Vengeful Spirit, so, or vice versa. They could be both like 4.5 role heroes, so. It's really going to boil down to which hero gets the better start. That hero is probably going to stick to being the 4, and then the other one will transition into a 5, and then they'll swap farm every now and then.
So, you know, now that you take a look at it, it honestly remaining. Wouldn't be too bad for the Akramaks to pick up something like the Pugna this game. The Firefly is going to be great versus, I mean, the Nether Ward is going to be great versus the Batrider. He pops Firefly, he's going to take a shot from the Nether Ward and his Blink is going to be disabled. It's strong versus the Ancient Apparition and the Sand King. And Decryptify, it's going to keep you alive from the Slark. The Marksman, I think they should be at least considering banning out the Pugna maybe.
Yeah, I think the Pugna would be a good choice. Not entirely sold on the Pugna though, because I still feel like they're going to need a little more in the physical DPS department on the side of Akramaks.
Okay.
To that effect, you might want to consider something like the Templar Assassin in the middle lane. It's a bit risky versus the Batrider, I get it, but...
Jesus.
Okay, this is a complete curveball. Akramaks. They did mention there's going to be some changes coming out here, but who the hell would have spotted an Arc Warden coming from a mile away? That's the first Arc Warden pick of Ucypher Season 1, and it's a last pick Arc Warden. This is the equivalent of getting Huskar'd. But at the same time, I'm not sure if this is the ideal game for him. Slark is one of the better ways to deal with him.
Yeah,
you sneak
Slark
up behind him, get within that magnetic field, beat the hell out of the Arc Warden before he knows what hit him.
Yep. I'm not sure if Flux can be dispelled by Dark Pact.
Not too sure about that myself.
But yeah,
it's a complicated mechanic. I think it's, you've got to ride the storm or stand next to a unit,
yeah,
an allied unit, to actually dispel the damage, but
last
I don't think you can get rid of it. Dark
for the Marksmen. They're looking for a mid laner.
How's the Queen of Pain in your books? Risky, I'd say, but an option, a viable option. She does okay versus the Arc Warden as well.
So, I don't know, I just have a preference that... Yeah, I was going to call the Tinker. That when you have a hero that split pushes on the enemy side, maybe you want somebody who can deal with that split push and rejoin the team. Tinker should be able to do that versus the Arc Warden.
There's limited ways for Akramaks to deal with this Tinker as well. The only real ways to spot him up in the trees is with
arrow.
The arrow or
maybe
the
vengeful,
wave. Yeah, the vengeful, yeah, wave of terror. But if Tinker slips up a little bit, he could be caught out by the Arc Warden himself, because as time progresses, Arc Warden gets extremely potent,
yeah,
versus the Tinker.
So it's going to be a hard lane for the Tinker. There's going to be an Ogre just running in at him. There's going to be the Arc Warden. It's going to be a particularly hard time for Zarq in the mid lane. There's only so much Pashik can do in terms of rotations, and Zarq has his work cut out for him. I'd like to possibly see him put points into the march, maybe even think about falling back to the jungle early on. And, yeah.
I mean, will it really be that difficult a lane for Zarq though? Because Ogre and Venge are both heroes that need to get up close and personal to actually deal with him. And coming in close to the Tinker essentially means you're going to have to take a lot more damage from the March spam. Tinker probably just chooses to max out the March as early as he possibly can, drops a March when they come ganking, and he almost always trades 1-for-2 or 1-for-1 in those situations.
Prepare to make way! Who made you captain?
But you know, at level 1 when there's an Ogre just running at you? That's what the Ogre's got to do, right?
Yeah, level 1 there's not too much they can do about that. I mean, maybe you could have the Ancient Apparition move there and use the Chilling Touch to slap him a little bit, but... that's about as good as it's going to get. There were some changes to Chilling Touch as well, if I'm not mistaken, at the...
You can... It doesn't slow your attack speed anymore.
Okay.
And, yeah, you could remove it if you wanted to. That's always been there.
And it applies the stacking slow. Stacking 30% slow for 0.3 seconds.
Okay.
So every auto attack does 30% slow. It stacks if multiple heroes hit you with the Chilling Touch buff. And if you hit again, the buff basically, it's sort of like a mini cold snap or something like the nullifier slow that comes up when you cast it.
I'm very impressed with what they're doing right now. Beautifully done, magic missile arrow. Really good Dota. Smoke moved through the mid lane. Two-man Baro Strike.
Oh,
Mage puts
nice
the point into pounce. But he got the Ignite. Well done. Beautiful coordination coming out from them. They scored a kill on the Slark. This should be a bounty rune for them. Really neat plays coming out from the Akramaks.
Yeah.
And no matter how disheartened they get by today's result, if it is indeed a negative one, that was phenomenal.
Yeah, that was really well done. One of the more coordinated smoke plays. Not every day that you get to see a smoke that moves through the middle lane into the jungle. It's one of the lesser known positions and it got the Slark completely off guard. So that's first blood and two bounty runes picked up by the Dire. Pretty good start, I have to say.
The Devil Jinpachi is playing the Bat Rider. He's literally stepped into Red's shoes here. He's going to be playing the offlane. He's going to be up against the Arc Warden.
Okay, but I was actually expecting this to be a mid Arc Warden. Looks like they're going to give him farm priority here. This should be a confirmed early Midas for him. And honestly, with the way the Batrider works, the Flux is going to do a fair bit of damage. Spark Wraith will be useful to spot him out inside the trees as well, so...
Yeah.
Anyway, bottom lane, Max is not having a fun time at all. They started with the Cold Feed, they're going to proc it along with the Pounce, and Max can do nothing but sink under his own weight.
Top lane, it's an offlaner for an offlaner.
Both sides, an eye for an eye. Blue Frog gets the kill on Devil Jinpachi. Already this game is off to an explosive start. Three kills on the board, just 1 minute in. These teams mean business. Zark is pulling the hell out of Make-Believe, by the way, in the lane. He's pushed the wave all the way under his tower. And that's going to prevent Make-Believe from getting perfect CS.
They might kill Jinpachi again.
Uh-oh.
They've got the Flux, yeah. They've got the Spark Wraith. Jinpachi dropping low. The Spark Wraith connects. It slows him down a bit. Hiko's got more than enough HP and armor. And Jinpachi, welcome to the main shade, sir.
Yeah, they're popping his cherry in half. Meanwhile, bottom, they want to return the favor because Max is getting jumped upon once more. Again, they're just going to go for the kill, but this time Max may just get out. One more hit will seal it. Pashu gets the kill, and that's without the Chilling Touch buff even being applied yet. Jinpachi says, all right, my teammates are going to welcome your offlaner back as well. Blue Frog boots first, Venge. He has the potential to get in close to Zark, but Zark's playing defensively. He's taken up the right side of the lane, which lets him go into the trees if needed.
Yeah, I mean, the mid lane's been an absolute whitewash. Make-Believe has 2 CS, while the Tinker has 9 CS and 5 denies.
One common trick that many middle laners use in when there's a gank coming in from the side is if the Tinker's standing on the defensive side, Mirana usually walks to this side of the river and starts auto-attacking as well. Subconsciously, Zark will want to move to this side and start fighting to get that angled hit off. That would essentially push him closer to the Venge to come in from the side and decimate him. Unfortunately, none of those mind games are happening. Pashu again going at it on Max, whose TP gets cancelled by the Cold Feed. Max is going to go down here. It's just delaying the inevitable. Mage just needs one more hit while Pashu smacks him in the back. Max is actually regenerating a lot here, but Mage will finish the job. But Jinpachi's gone down on the top lane again.
Both offlaners adept at giving kills to the enemy side lane.
How dare you feed without me, says Jinpachi.
Yeah, I was taking a look at the mid lane in the midst of that. It seemed as if Blue Frog went in, took a whole lot of damage, and the Arc Warden pretty much secured the kill all by himself. The good news for Jinpachi is that the Creep Wave is under his tower. That's going to give him level 3. The bad news for Max is that the Creep Wave is far, far away.
And the bad news for both of them is that there isn't a single stack camp in the jungle. There's no way for them to catch up. They just have to ride out the storm, and Itachi God is going to come here to help Devil Jinpachi stick around in the lane. But again, middle lane, Zark is being pressured with Kiko and Blue Frog just running in at him. They're going to go with the Ignite. The arrow actually caught him.
The arrow connects. Blue Frog can go in. They're underleveled on the supports, but they should be able to get the kill. There's a quick Baro Strike. The Star Storm is there. Max dropping low. You got the Ignite upon him. The Wave of Terror as well. Making him close the kill. Itachi God, can he find a response? Pashu's coming in as well, so both mid laners end up falling down while Itachi God manages to survive courtesy the sandstorm.
Now Blue Frog could be in trouble himself. He's playing ring around the rose here. And yeah, the Duke was successful, but meanwhile, Zark is TP'd to the shrine to try and find Kiko. Kiko's got enough HP to just walk out of your company. This game, absolutely dead even right now. Just 4 minutes in, a 1,000 net worth lead swinging in favor of Marksmen. But that means nothing when both teams are losing exact heroes on the opposite lanes here. Max, though, on the bottom lane. This time he could be going down without Devil's Party falling in exchange, but here comes Kiko from behind. Smacks him with a Fire Blast and Ignite for good measure, and then a couple of auto attacks to send Mage back. Dark Pact, this could kill him.
This, he shrugs off the Ignite, but if Kiko doesn't get juke, yeah. So this is the first win in the laning stage 21 at all.
Max has had enough, man. He's come to the lane with 2 mangoes now, knowing that if he survives, he can just come back with an extra regeneration. And it's working for him. With the Slark dead for a while, he's just going to lap up as much farm and EXP that he can. While top lane, Jinpachi's actually got his buddies coming in.
Mm-hmm. They want Dream. I don't think Blue Frog has a TP, but he's making his way towards the top lane. No TP indeed, this is going to run Jinpachi. Down Dream. 4 stacks of sticky napalm, but Jinpachi, I mean, there are towers that this early on in the game. Itachi God might just survive, that Butter Strike keeps him alive.
What was he thinking?
I'm not sure. Dream still gets the kill. I think Itachi God walked into a Spark Raid.
No, Dream dropped the Spark Raid. They're expecting him to be around.
Yeah,
but
okay.
Yeah, that's just questionable stuff coming out from Devil Jinpachi. Does he not know how Arc Warden works? You can't go diving into an Arc Warden when you have no allied units or creeps near you. Flux will decimate you, and that's exactly what happened. Zark got himself that bottle online, but that's all he's really picked up. His boots not available just yet. That makes it
this is well done. Haste rune on the Mirana, good smoke coming up from both the supports. The 6-minute mark is usually when your mid-ward times are, and they make the most of it.
Absolutely. They've also managed to find that sweet spot where the Tinker didn't have his boots, so there was no way he was running ahead away from that.
Why
also
did Tinker not buy boots?
We also saw Mirana employing that subtle mind technique there, by the way. She was on the right side of the lane, forcing Tinker to move towards the center of the lane, which allowed the bench to get in place. Good stuff. This is a whole different Akramaks
scene. Oh, top lane. Itachi God. I haven't seen a Vengeance Spirit have so much impact in the laning phase in a while. And she can go once more. She has the Arcane Rune. Jinpachi walks in the lane without the Firefly. Kiko's more than happy to run in at them. There is the Arc Warden as well, and eventually they should be able to get the kill. It's a double kill for Blue Frog, and he's dominating on this Vengeance Spirit.
Whatever changes they've made seem to be working fantastically here for them. These lane switches, these position roles, these role switches, it's working really well.
Yeah.
Blue Frog, he's always been that high impact four that we've seen him to be. But coupled up with Kiko, he's playing some really good Dota. They're on the same page, moving together, moving from lane to lane, winning every single lane for their teammates.
Yeah, I mean, without a doubt, for the entirety of the tournament, this is the best support play I've seen in the laning phase. I haven't seen supports that have been so active and got so much accomplished this early on. 2 kills on the Tinker. One which was a trade of sorts because the Mirana ended up dying. And a kill on the Slark. And multiple deaths on Jinpachi. I'm not even keeping track. I think I should just leave my camera up on Jinpachi. Dream though, he might have to back off because there's a Sand King in the vicinity.
Look at that spark.
Look at that heart. This tower is dropping. Oh, Blue Frog comes in. He's got the magic missile. Itachi God works for the
Sand King.
He's got it. The spark rate is another spark rate from Jinpachi.
They just can't do anything on this top lane. Whoever comes just ends up going down. Dream is now dominating, and Blue Frog is going to get out of here very comfortably as well. Jinpachi, he may have the triangle to boost, but his Firefly is worn off.
This is silly. Come on. The last time he did this, he dived at tier 1 and ended up there.
There's a regen rune Mirana available here.
They're going to go with the stun. The adder to follow through. That could be another death on Jinpachi. 8 minutes in. If this isn't feeding, I don't know what is.
And they're going to get Pashu as well. The leap forward was there. The secondary leap as well. Pashu rests in peace as Make Believe gets a double kill. All this while the Tidehunters hit level 6 on the bottom lane. The Ravage has yet to be committed. They've got 14 kills on the board. What happened to Akramaks? I mean, what brand of Chyawanprash have they been consuming, and where can I get some? Because this is a whole different team.
So, I mean, a lot of this was on the back of this one ward away, which allowed them to continuously bully the Octane. And now it's timed out. They might be looking to have impacts.
Look at bottom though. Max has an opportunity to kill Mage by himself with the Ravage and the Anchor Smash. Mage can't afford to be low in this lane any longer because the cavalry has come, Kiko and Blue Frog. They've done enough to Devil Jinpachi. It's time to go bully Mage on the bottom lane and slow him down a bit. In terms of net worth, that Arc Warden is just snowballing forward. He's picked up the Midas already and Boots online as well. He's nigh unkillable, but they're gonna come in with a smoke this time around. Devil Jinpachi has yet to hit level 6.
They need to get this kill on Dream.
Oh yeah.
Somehow keep him slacking. Yeah, I think Dream is done for.
Finally, they're gonna get a kill.
Yeah, the numbers are just overwhelming him. Make the leave Blue Frog as well as Kiko hunting for the slack.
This gives Zark enough time just to keep farming for his BOTs. Unfortunately, he can't go to the middle lane because there's a party happening when he's not invited. Mm-hmm. Maybe things get a little easier once Zark gets his BOTs.
Blue Frog, this is a kill. He can do it by himself with the medallion, yeah. Maybe he gets the last hit. Well done. And Max is also moving in that direction. He's got the Ravage. Jinpachi. Yeah, he's learned his lesson. Hide in the fountain. Cover under the safety of your fountain. But yeah, he's gonna give up the tower.
He absolutely has to.
That's a neat play. I mean, come on, if you have an observer, right? Yeah, if you have the Radiant Observer and you still end up going down to the Tidehunter, it's just silly.
Anyway, bottom lane, Blue Frog comes in to stop his own tier 1 tower from going down. So it's a trade in favor of Akramaks once more. The question is, what do they now do with this space that's opened up on the top side of the map? There's also this subtle push that's going to come out from Akramaks with the Vengeful Spirit damage aura and the Bloodlust attack speed bonus going up onto the Mirana. Mirana is one of those range heroes that has a little more range than the rest. Her attack range sits at about 630.
Mm-hmm. I do not mind the medallion pickup on Blue Frog, but I'd like to see him get in Hood if he's still farming at a good rate early on. If he can get a Hood sometime around the same time as Max picking up his mech, it's going to be really useful for himself in the team.
Anyway, Blue Frog is going in on bottom. Mage, you can no longer disjoint the Magic Missile, so he's just trying to force out that Shadow Dance, but it seems unlikely that he's going to get it to do so.
So Flux can be dispelled.
A Radiant using echolocation?
Today I learned. But they've still got the Ravage online anyway, and it looks like they're going to use the threat of it to try and pressure this bottom tier 1 tower. Might be best to have the Mirana rotating there as well though.
Smart move coming up from Mage. He's just given up the tier 1 and he's trying to catch Dream. Dream did move into the Radiant jungle to pick up a bounty rune, and they were hoping to punish that with their Observer. But Dream got the hell out of there, and this means that the Slark might not be there to defend this tier 1 if the push indeed does come. Itachi God is here. He's kept the epicenter, but it's going to be hard to just defend all by himself.
They've even dropped an Observer Ward just outside the periphery of that tier 1 tower, so they want to have full vision of this fight going into it. Tower faces a stiff it's an win. Unconventional Observer Ward. Maybe it was placed before they actually came to the tower itself, but it looks like they're going to get the tower uncontested now. Itachi's waiting, but there's not much he can do here. If he attempts to deny, he's going to end up losing his life. Mm-hmm.
Dream just needs to stay alive in the top lane, and he's doing just that. He has sent the Tempest double ahead.
Yeah, and the double Midas. The money's starting to stack up. He's at 6.1k net worth and has that Maelstrom queued up already. The tower dead, just being delayed a little bit by that fortification. But Itachi God, his presence is still unaware here. He's still just lurking in the trees, hoping that he can get some free farm here if three of those heroes walk away. And it looks like they're going to do that. They're going to TP towards the middle lane where Mage is farming unsuspectingly.
Do you think the Akramaks have enough of a lead to maybe just pick up a gem once the Tidehunter gets his mech and start grouping up?
I mean, why the hell not? Tide's the ideal candidate to hold on to the gem this game. I mean, their lineup checks a whole bunch of boxes. They've got a way to deal with the lasso with the Vengeful Spirit Swap. They've got a way to initiate with possible arrows, possible ravages. They've got a free farmer on the side who'll come online in the late game stage as well.
Partial didn't put a point into the ice block. Now he has. Okay.
Invisibility. That seems like a big mistake though.
Hey, he's He didn't take it at 6, he took it at 7. I don't know how many opportunities were missed because of that. But yeah, Blue Frog in his room. He's going to meet his old friend Devilsman Pashu, just checking on that old man.
But they're going to go for Pashu instead. Yeah, he's just standing here.
Radiant's middle tower, ice flush towards the top lane.
Dream should know this is coming.
Okay, so they're just giving up towers.
Okay, Pashu's done. They're swapping in close enough, but Pashu's there holding it. It's longer. Arrow won't connect, but the Anchor Smash sure will. Devilsman Pashu. He was thinking about going in there for a minute, but then he realized he's got no Firefly, so it's best not to. Zark and Itachi short. They'll take a tower on the bottom lane, at least do a fair bit of damage upon it. They have 3 range creeps, they should get this tower. But they will sacrifice their middle tier. Never mind, they're even going to pop a fortification and come in to defend.
Max is TP then.
That should be a deny on the tier 1. And there's not much that the Sand King and the Tinker can do about it. That's the full mech on the Tyrant.
And Jinpachi's picked up his blink.
Things could change from here on out. If they use that blink dagger perfectly, find some isolated pickoffs, and you know, continue to delay the time between the next push and a possible Roshan attempt, I think we could see Marksmen making a comeback here. It's not such a devastating lead that they've got anyway. Oh, Mage, he got spotted, or at least he got tagged by a spark wave.
Tagged by the spark right there. They're moving towards the top lane. They have the ice blast.
Shadowblade's gonna wear off though.
But they got protection. It says sentry nearby. Well, I guess they're looking for the Sand King to get things started. The magic missile will connect. The fire blast won't pass the goes in with the chilling touch. And the ice blast manages to clip Dream. They're trying to bring Dream down. The moonlight shadow is there, but they've got detection. They've got the vision. They bring down Dream. They'll take down Blue Frog as well. And that's his dominating streak put to an end.
Yeah, this is not the way they wanted to play. The absence of the Tyrant in that fight hurt them quite heavily. He had no TP scroll to work with. It was on cooldown. And Make Believe chose not to TP in there either. That's quite a painful blow delivered, because while the... The Arc Warden is farming quite a bit. He is still that fat spring chicken that's coming home to roost. And it looks like Marksmen are going to be able to claim the money for it. He's worth a lot more money, but his money's not being put into survivability just yet, so it's still easy pickings. That's exactly what they needed to do with that Blink Dagger on Devilsman Pashu. Go in for the high value kill, ensure the kill with the Ice Blast, and then proceed to decimate everyone else. It also helps that they had detection placed down to deal with that Moonlight Shadow.
Yeah. It's also worth noting that Blue Frog was busy, so he couldn't swap to disjoint the lasso and keep the Slark alive. Arc Warden alive.
Well, Dream, while he may have been set back a little bit, he's still on top of the net worth chart, seconded only by his ally, aka Mirana Make Believe. He's making progress towards a Manta style. Dark on the other hand. Not to go for the Blink Dagger, going for the Kaya first. This is risky, but it could pay big dividends. Oh, they smoked
under.
They smoked under a ward.
Come on, the Slark should be calling that out.
They absolutely need to be calling that out. That was silly.
Shadow Dance shouldn't be active when you're under a ward. Mage should have just taken a look at his status bar. Jinpachi's going in. Who's he looking for? He's managed to catch Mirana. This time, Blue Frog has the swap. Jinpachi has been turned upon. The Ravage clips the Slark. They bring him down with a gush. Make Believe is dominating. Dream comes in from the back. They're trying to bring down the Sand King, and it looks like they will. Pashu left to himself. Blue Frog, can he close the gap here? The missiles, as well as the March, will push them back. Make Believe starting with the arrow. Connect, but Max is here with the charge, and Make Believe jumps in with the Star Storm. Mage trying to man up, pops the Shadow Dance, forces Anamik Eco running after him in the piece. Pocket number one, pocket number two should be coming in, and Dream scores the kill.
That was a lot of damage from the Spark Ray, but that's 4 down on the side of the Radiant, and Akramaks lose absolutely nothing in the play there. Great reactions coming out from Blue Frog. That insta swap disjointing the lasso allowed them to turn that fight in their favor. They also just barely sidestepped the Ice Blast, which gave them a little more wiggle room in the fight, giving Make Believe that double kill to open things up. Let's not forget the Ravage that clipped on 3 over there. Max, in the right place at the right time for a change.
Yeah.
It's
Now, Jinpachi's got to be careful. Melly can't.
He showed that Tempest double who's boss.
I mean, he's got to be careful with his initiation.
Zark. He did go for the Blink Dagger, so no Kaya shenanigans right off the bat. Thankfully, no Kaya shenanigans off the bat.
Yeah, he needs that Blink for
sure. If I'm not wrong, he was the only survivor in that fight.
Because he was the only person who didn't participate in that fight. But he was there with the rockets from Drain and the March as well. Anyway, Moonlight Shadow, it seems as if they want to fight once more. They haven't got the Ravage, but they might be bumping into Mage. Have they got Detection though? Blue Frog walks in, and Mage, this time, he's taking a look at his status buff. He knows that there are people nearby.
Good call. Now they know where the entirety of Akramaks are, and they'll be able to bail from this fight quite convincingly, or quite conveniently. But this relentless aggression coming out from Akramaks, it's something that could come back to bite them in the behind later on. Because you're only strong when your threat of the Ravage or the actual Ravage is actually there. That's when you've got a major power spike going for you. Without the Ravage, the Tidehunter is nothing but the carrier of a mechanism. Let's not forget though, there's an ancient apparition with the Ice Blast on the other side, which means that the Tidehunter brings almost nothing to the table without the Ravage when the Ice Blast is online. I don't think they should be overstepping their boundaries like this. Like we said, it's only a 4,000 net worth lead, and now we're 20 minutes in. This isn't entirely domination coming out from Akramaks, despite the scoreboard leading you to believe that it would be the case.
Yeah.
Slark is one of those heroes that punishes complacency very hard. He's one that can go into the backlines, go cheekily picking off heroes that are isolated. And towards the late game phase, he's also going to be preying straight on Dream and that Arc Warden if they're not careful.
Mm-hmm.
But they'll back off, come back in with the smoke again, and all the while the Ravage is still down. No pick off there. We'll see an instant blink away from Devil Jinpachi, who's now revealed their positions. Another smoke / Moonlight Shadow wasted.
Radiant's middle tower. Yeah, that was a wasted smoke, but the objective for the Akramaks is quite clear. Let's group up, let's push, let's take towers. They have the Ravage coming up cool down around 10 seconds. Pressure upon Jinpachi to find the perfect initiation. Make believe with the double damage drone. But it's the thing that's leave more than enough to hold them back for the time being.
Tide's not even going for the Blink Dagger this game. He's just going for the fight first, dealing with the Tinker and then into the Passion. Honestly, seems like the right choice here.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm also wondering if the mech was. Yeah, I guess it never really hurts to have one. Anyway, they did pop a dust on the side there, not able to find anyone with it. However,
but they
the
get
tier 2 tower goes down. At the same time, Mage finds a tier 1 on the top side.
That peeping top by the numbers. It's unlikely that they can find the skill. And I just think the Ogre and the Milano could have hung around bottom. But Dream has to come back to defend. He's not picked up the BOTs, he's going for it only now. And yeah, one of the stronger things of an Arc Warden is pretty much having the same hero with the same global presence in the form of the Tempest Double.
Yeah, I'm a little confused as to why he chose to get the Shadow Blade before the Boots of Travels.
Yeah, it's unusual, right? You want to pick up that BOT so that, I mean,
so that your illusion can be literally everywhere. Your Tempest Double can be anywhere at any time, pushing out a wave or finding a pick off. I don't like the fact that he skipped it, but he's playing a very farm heavy Arc Warden, one that could be punished in the later stages of the game. Anyway, yeah.
But again, it boils down to the fact that what do you do with all that farm? You farm, that's okay, but you gotta have some impact in the game with all that farm. I'm also a bit surprised that Lewis is not calling out these observers. Or maybe he is, but the supports aren't getting them dewarded.
Look at this though. They're just gonna walk straight past Itachi God.
Yeah.
Who's now gonna have his Blink Dagger. If he dies here, that's gonna be quite a crucial kill, but it seems like he's moving towards the bottom lane. Either to buy a TP straight off the bat or to...
Damn, he went to the creep. Dream sees him, the flux is there. He pops the sandstorm, another spark rate on the ground. Itachi God looking for the TP. Have they got anything to cancel? No, they haven't. But they're gonna group up and push once more.
Space created, Blink Dagger acquired, no harm done, and Mage continues to farm on the top.
I think
we're slowly seeing Marksmen claw their way back into this game, creating space for their cores and continuing with item progression. Yeah, look at this. Instantly deciding to ditch that bottom tier 2 fight, instead going for a tier 2 on the top lane themselves. I like this. This is some smart decision making coming out from the Marksmen. They're showing why they were considered the top contenders of the Ucypher League at one point. And all it really takes is one good game for the entire squad to find their momentum again, right? It's what we saw with Yodhas, it's what we've seen with Yakshas, and now perhaps Marksmen could find their recovery once again by making a comeback in this game. However, I mean, it is going to be
coming in. Kiko goes in with the Fire Blast. Jinpachi just left the Slark. They've gotten a detection for his shrugged off the dust, but they're moving towards Pashu. Pashu, though, in fog, will end up surviving. They don't get the tier 2, but yeah, they create some space to farm. Green testing his limits there against the Sand King. So now the Tempest Double being dealt with rather easily here.
Watch for Blue Frog though, again the Dark Pack.
Got Mace, the Dark Pack, Shadow Blade. He's gonna bind himself some time, make it leave his nearby. The Ace Troop is what's keeping Mage alive. He even pops the Shadow Dance.
It's being a nuisance there. 60 seconds without a Shadow Dance now. That's not an incentive to really go, but it still basically adds some security on the side of Akramaks, because you know that the Slark is unlikely to go hunting without his Dark Pack, without his Shadow Dance available. Kiko! He's piss poor, man. He's level 12 with just Brown Boots and the Orb of Venom. He's been buying all the wards. Heck, he hasn't even been able to upgrade his boots this game.
He's fine. He's got a 60 GPM talent there. But yeah, some of these GPM talents are a bit of a joke. It's like when my mom used to give me 10 rupees a week and say, hey, pocket money. it's not much.
Yeah, 60 GPM is like a creep. Or two creeps.
Yeah. At best. A minute? Ice Frog is laughing at these supports with this DPM talents. The Akramaks, they've worked hard, they've accrued a decent lead. It's not that they're running away with the game just yet, but they are taking a fair amount of map control.
Ice Blast, completely off the mark there. Equivalent of a Dota wide bomb. But they're going in now, with the pipe and the mech complete, with Arc Warden in the vicinity as well. They're just going to beat up on a tier 2 and get it for free. Mage, well, not entirely free, because Mage is going to get the tier 1 in the middle lane. He's picked up a Basho in addition to the Shadow Blade, and that Midas is now starting to pay dividends for him, but he doesn't have a TP for 30 seconds. Mage has no TP for 30 seconds, and high ground has been reached.
Yet, I'm not sure what the call is. They're moving towards the Slark. There's no way they catch him. Someone should have kept tabs on the Slark. I mean, heck, just for the items that he's managed to purchase. Mage, this is just ridiculous. He's skipping the creep wave.
Talk about space creation. Now he's gonna TP back out, so a lot of space created. At the same time, you've got a three-man smoke coming out from the Sand King, Ancient Apparition, and Devil Jinpachi's Batrider. Make believe he could be caught here for this double damage rune. Oh, Jinpachi! Oh man, that's premature ejaculation right there. He jumps in for the DD rune instead of using it as bait.
Yeah, and immediate smoke coming up from the boys over at the Akramaks. They are on the hunt. I think they saw the Slark for a second with their Dire Observer. Mage needs to be careful here. He's trying to build into that linkage here. Blue Frog goes in, the swap is there. A quick pounce followed by the Dark Pack, but the lockdown. It's there by the plenty, and make believe is wicked sick.
That was greedy. He chose to Shadow Blade instead of Shadow Dance.
Yeah.
And that gets him killed. That one is entirely on him. He could have survived that. He could have created space for his teammates, but his greed got the better of him. And now because of that, they're going to get the Aegis as well. And really, I don't think there's anything that Marksman can do about it.
Bloody good piece. I mean, if Slark player, you play Slark a bit, you should know that the Observer's watching you. There was an Observer right there where the previous Shrine used to be, but he completely missed that.
Actually, he's not paying attention to his movement speed dropping up and down, changing up and down throughout his movement through the map. But they've got a 13 second window with no Slark. They have a Ravage, the pipe gets deployed already. And they're going in onto the high ground. Was it really the smart?
Oh, they managed to catch Blue Frog though. This kill is something. It's the Vengeance Spirit taken down. Jinpachi, second last of the game, resulting in a kill. But is it enough to put an end to the push?
Questionable stuff. Max used the pipe for about 3 creeps over there to go into the high ground. And when Jinpachi saw the opportunity on the Vengeance Spirit on the side, he's the only hero they can lasso without fear of his joint, so he might as well get it. Good kill there, Jinpachi. the place for his team.
Lock, make quick work of the Mirana, make the leap. Look at the leap away. Pop the Manda style. Oops, the leap again.
I'm actually staying. Oh, he caught him with the second pass, and that's all 3 leaps taken away. Make believe, mech is down.
Mech? Oh, he didn't pop the mech, he popped the Ralph instead, but where's the follow up? His mech was on cooldown.
The Ralph is actually missed control on main. The as well. Marksmen, oh man. They have just made them look like idiots. Mage takes the Aegis and the kill on the Mirana under a tier 1 tower.
No,
I don't think the tier 1 tower is there, I'm sorry.
No, he took down that tier 1 earlier.
But he baits out a Ravage and no one dies. That's huge. Blue Frog. Blue Frog.
Oh, they are right. Takes the last hit, gets the kill.
We all know complete on the dream, and that's gonna augment the push.
Yep.
No back for 40 seconds, but he's got a buyback. No rabbit on the side of Akramaks. Yeah, I don't think you push. I really don't think you push if you're Akramaks right now. This could hurt them so bad.
They're not going to, but they're going to probably try and do some chip damage just to temper stuff. I don't think that's going to work too much.
Zark's also got the admin set for the spell life again.
Kill! A slap! Dire's middle tower is under pressure. Dire's middle tower is under attack. Dire's middle tower is under pressure.
Radiant's bottom tower is a stiff wind. Radiant structures are fortified.
Dire's top tower is about to take the blow. Double kill! Dire's top tower is under
that.
I'll take your tribute.
Selfish.
Will. Dire's bottom tower won't last long. Dire's bottom tower is under attack. Radiant are scanning for enemies. Middle barracks have fallen.
Guess they got inundated.
Radiant's bottom tower is on its last bound.
Radiant's top tower is under attack. Radiant's top tower is on the rock.
Why are they bailing? There's still a range barracks to finish. There's no slack for 70. There's no ancient barracks for 30. Okay, they don't have the Aegis and
they're expecting the thing, but I mean, Zach can't throw more than one.
The Aegis has worn off, so that's probably it. But Dream is busy beating up Itachi God with his Tempest Domino.
He's going in.
JB Pop, he's gone for the barracks.
He's gone for the barracks.
He's gonna get him as well.
Come on.
Nope. But yeah, honestly, this is all they have to do. Just keep sending a BKB Tempest Double onto the
item. BKB Mirana, BKB Tempest Double. Take structure by structure. You still got the cheese on Max. Maybe you swap it over to a more useful teammate, and this should be the game for the Akramaks.
But let's be realistic here. Teams in Ucypher do like to try and defend versus Mega Creeps as well. Unfortunately, I don't think Akramaks, I don't think Marksman has the lineup to defend Mega Creeps. Tinker's not so good versus that entire wave, three waves of creeps pushing in time and again. And unfortunately, the Slark is not going to help in that department courtesy his itemization either. Yeah. If anything, he's going to have to sell off a couple of items and build Mjolnir and such for himself. And even then, it's going to be an extremely tall order to try and push up. I mean, huge props to Marksman for attempting a defense here, but I just don't see it happen.
Well, for now the Akramaks are moving on the shrine has fallen. And Max is joining them in a bit on that Tide Hunter with Ravage coming off cooldown.
But Dream, this is Mission Kashmir all over again. He's just running by himself, getting to the range barracks. BKB, do it, man. Alright, there it is. BKB Hex, everything.
He's in the magnetic field. Wait. His Tempest Double just died out. Okay, so they popped the Moonlight Shadow, but they actually dispelled it themselves near the Radiant Reaper. That's not too smart a play, Kiko. And now I think they pretty much know what's going on. If they don't, yeah, they do. They spotted that out. I like the attempt.
I don't.
I like the attempt.
I really don't.
I don't like how they execute it.
No, I don't like the attempt.
I like
either,
the thought. But there we go. Mission Kashmir Part 2. Bad movies always have more sequels. And the Arcwarden goes down once more.
Range barracks. It's like one damage per minute that they're going to be doing here. So we're looking at another 200 minutes of gameplay. Manta illusions. This is what they made for make believe. Spawn them and send them.
Zarth has a cheap deck, but okay, right, look at this.
They've had enough.
Nullify upon Max, upon Mage. They commit the Ravage, Dream focusing the Slark. They control him with the cheap stick. This should be a kill. He pops the DKB. He looks at the epicenter is there. They managed to take down Blue Frog. The laser bouncing between all of them and Mage stealing stacks upon stacks of Ascension. They managed to bring down Jinpachi. Dream doing a whole lot of the damage. The arrow clips on Itachi God. Kiko calls the well played.
That's
what?
An offensive GG.
That hurts. That is painful and Mage might be punished for that. First, he's going to move on to Dream, making him instant dropping low. Doesn't have the Aegis anymore. The Barrow Strike is there. They're going to get Dream indeed. And that's 100 seconds with Dark PR quarters.
But he has a buyback and Mega Creeps and Tier 2s to stop the enemy team from finishing.
Yeah.
I don't know what they're defending for. This is it. This is game over for them. That range barracks was the last nail in the coffin for Akramaks. You can already see Mage struggling with these creeps on the sides here.
I honestly don't know what they're defending for. Call it pride, call it ego, call it izzat, call it... I don't know.
Honestly, cyber cafe time. I think that's cyber cafe what you want to call it. What's the alternative? Go home and play more Dota, right?
Yeah, go home and play more Dota. I don't blame them. I think they just love the gear coming out from Circle Gaming here. Look at Itachi God. I mean, I would understand that if he hit multiple creeps at the cockpit. I don't think even Itachi God knows what he's playing for at this point.
Yeah, I think they're done, man. You can see defeat in their eyes, both in the game and on the stage.
Zach's picked up a sheep thing, so let's take a look if it has any impact.
I mean, why end this game when you can take another Roshan, right? But I don't think one Roshan will cut it. I think they need to wait for another Roshan up.
That's
the safest play.
That's the safest play. And you've got to get those FPS down.
This is a test age. Like a prototype of the actual world.
I think India has the highest number of Rotan kills.
Also have the longest average game time, if I'm not wrong. Chinese Dota now.
Yeah.
Although Chinese Dota got really good.
These matches are going on Dota buff. I guess.
I don't think so.
Anyway, they'd be shit confused as to what is going on. Shadows, take us. The numbers wouldn't make sense. Blue Frog. Moonlight Shadow, Ghost Scepter, Link Dagger. Okay, Mage still wants to defend. He's got the Silver Edge complete. In addition to that Skadi and that BKB, they're standing outside the base and then looking for their way in. Arrow upon Parsu. Dinpati pops his BKB, flies around, struts around, looks for the lasso, gets the throw, gets hit and runs right back. There's the epicenter. That's what the plan was. It manages to catch a couple of them, but Nekmini just pops his BKB and turns around. Mage being focused and nullified upon him. There's not a thing in the world this lock can do. The arrow clips on Upasho in his own fountain, and he finally ends up going down.